Hello, everyone. UK Minister for Investment, Lord Grimstone, High Commissioner of India to the UK, Her Excellency, Ms. Gayatri Kumar, CEO of Grant Thornton UK, Dave Dunkley, Director General of CII, Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, Lord Popat, Lord Billimoria, Lord Moylan, Baroness Prasher, and all our guests and friends on the India-UK corridor who have joined us today for the launch of the India Meets Britain Tracker Report. A very warm welcome, a very good morning to everyone joining us in the UK, and good afternoon to everyone joining us from India. We are here for the launch of the 8th edition of the India Meets Britain Tracker Report, produced by Grant Thornton UK in collaboration with our partners, the Confederation of Indian Industry. And we are here to celebrate the success of Indian companies in the UK over the years, and also to look at the India-UK trade and economic partnership for the future. So without much ado, can I request CEO of Grant Thornton UK, David Dunkley, to come online. David has been with the firm since 1998. And he has been at the helm of the firm since 2018, leading us through success in these challenging times. So over to David for his welcome remarks. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Chandru, and good morning and or good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to welcome Minister Lord Grimstone, India High Commissioner Mrs. Kumar, the CII, the Director General of CII, Mr. Banerjee, and as the Lord members and our friends and contacts. I wish you a really, really warm welcome to this 8th edition of the India Meets Britain Tracker, which we've done, as Chandru says, in conjunction with the Confederation of Indian Industry. Now, our Safe South Asian Business Group has been something we're really, really very proud of at Grant Thornton, which has been under Anoush Shande's esteemed leadership now for a number of years, supported excellently by Chandru. We have been supporting this corridor now for more than three decades, and we have a really close collaboration, particularly with our India member firm, who's one of our closest friends in our international network. As you've seen from the opening video, our tracker really stood the test of time since 2014, and now we're really proud of it. I think it's a genuine piece of thought leadership, which really highlights the value of Indian businesses in the UK. So with that, I wish the launch the very, very best of success, and congratulate everybody who's part of this call and every Indian business who continues to contribute a huge amount to the prosperity of the UK. And on that, I'm going to hand back to Chandru for the launch itself.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you very much for that. And can I just request you to stay on, and while I request all our other dignitaries, Minister Grimstone, High Commissioner Ms. Gayatri Kumar, Chandrajit Banerjee of CII, Amit Kapoor of TCS, my colleague Anuj Chande from Grant Thornton, and Mr. Jay Shroff from UPI Limited, to can you please switch on your cameras and join us for the formal report launch activity. Thank you.
Yes, good morning. Good morning.
Yes, Minister. Thank you. Thank you very much. Can we have the official formal launch of the report, please? Thank you, Dwayne. Thank you. Thank you very much. The 8th edition of the India Meets Britain Tracker Report, produced by Grant Thornton in collaboration with CII, has been officially launched now. And thank you, everyone, all our dignitaries, for your support on this. Really much appreciated. We will quickly move on to our keynote speakers. But before that, I just wanted to make a mention that the link to download the report will be available at the end of this session. And will also be available on the chat box for you to click on it and download it. Can I just request all our other speakers to switch off their cameras and request Minister Grimstone to stay back with us for his keynote address. Thank you, everyone. Mr. Grimstone, thank you very much for joining us for this launch. Really much appreciated. You have been a phenomenal friend of India-UK relationships for a very, very long time. And you've taken up this role of the UK Minister of Investment since last year. Very, very challenging times. But as you would see in the report, despite the challenges, we had some great successes coming along. So Can I request you to share your keynote address with us on the launch of the India Meets Britain Tracker Report, sir? Over to you, sir, Lord Grimstone.
Yes, well, thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for inviting me here this morning, this afternoon. As the UK's Minister for Investment, and indeed, as you said, someone who has a very long history of doing business in India, I'm delighted to be here with Her Excellency, the High Commissioner, Mrs. Gayatri Kumar. I think this report is a fantastic exercise. It's great that it gives us this kind of time series, and it's become such a consistent barometer for the strength of the UK-India relationship, as well as the importance of India as one of our most important bilateral investors and job creators. Indeed, I would go so far to say that you look at the consistency, that India is probably our most important bilateral investor and job creator. I've had a sneak look at some of the findings of the report. I won't steal the thunder of people speaking later, but it shows some really great progress just over the last year. What a terrible year though we've been through. Which of us could have imagined that the pandemic would cause the global ravaging that it has? And of course, my heart goes out to our friends in India, you know, who are still, you know, suffering greatly from the pandemic. The good thing, I suppose, that's come out of it is that our two nations have supported each other throughout the pandemic. We've kept critical supply chains open to ensure supplies and access to PPE, vital healthcare products, pharmaceuticals, and now, of course, to the vaccine. Pay great tribute to the Serum Institute in Pune. Our Trade Secretary went there recently, and that's been a great source of the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine for the world. The data in the barometer absolutely shows the continued strength of the UK-India relationship. But good though it is now, I have to say that I think we're now approaching a phase, an era, where it's going to be even stronger. We're absolutely determined to deepen our economic links with India. I know that's absolutely reciprocated by our Indian friends. And as the Prime Minister set out in our integrated review of foreign policy last month, the UK-India strategic relationship is only going to go one way. It's going to become more important for us in the coming decade as the UK grows to be even a more important trade and investment partner. I hear the phrase Indo-Pacific every day during my ministerial work now, which is a bit of a symbol of how things have changed. Sadly, as we know, the Prime Minister's visit has had to be postponed. Mr. Modi and our Prime Minister agreed that was the right thing to do. But I know there is going to be some virtual interaction shortly, and I know that the visit will be replanned for later in the year. I'm so excited about that visit because the Trade Secretary has already agreed with Minister Goyal to launch an enhanced trade partnership. And I really believe that at long last, we may now be on a path which will end up with our two great nations entering into a free trade agreement. So just in conclusion, I'm very proud that the UK remains one of the top destinations in Europe for Indian investors, and that's from startups to scale-ups to international conglomerates, Indian companies, for example, you know, TCS, still creating jobs at a huge rate in India, and the report shows that. So again, can I just welcome this tracker, and great that it is showing such fantastic progress between our two countries.
Thank you very much, Minister Lord Grimstone. Your kind words are very much appreciated by all of us here. And we really look forward to the Indian investments in the UK growing in the years to come after we come out of this dreaded pandemic. Thank you very much, sir, for spending the time with us for this report launch. Really, really appreciate that. Can I now introduce our next keynote speaker, our very own High Commissioner of India to the UK, Ms. Gayatri Sarkumar. Ms. Kumar took charge of this role last year in the UK after spending time in Belgium and the EU. And really, really challenging times. But even in these challenging times, ma'am has been at the forefront of prioritizing and strengthening the India-UK relationships. Ma'am, over to you for your remarks on the launch of the India Meets Britain Tracker Report. Thank you. Ma'am, you may need to unmute yourself, ma'am.
Am I audible now?
Yes, please. Yes, fine. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Excellency, Lord Gerry Grimstone, Honourable Minister for Investment, Government of the UK, Sri Anuj Chande, Head of South Asia Business Group, Grant Thornton. I don't see Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, DG of the CII on the screen, but if he's here, a warm good morning, good afternoon to him. I welcome the launch of the latest India Meets Britain Tracker Report. I've just seen the beautiful cover and I'm really delighted. I'm glad to see that, as the Honourable Minister said, that there is a positive trend which continues, which is fully in consonance with the present state of the India-UK bilateral relations. The UK has been, as has just been mentioned, even as a member of the EU, a key trade and investment partner of India. And after Brexit as well, trade and investment flows between India and the United Kingdom have remained on a positive trajectory despite the pandemic even. And this report identifies the top Indian investors in the UK in 2020, highlighting top Indian employers based on data from 850 limited companies owned directly or indirectly or controlled by an Indian parent company or citizen. So that's what's new about this report. And it's a matter of satisfaction to see that the bare facts reflect a success story, not only for the Indian companies, but also in terms of their local contribution of revenue and taxes here in the UK and employment generation. So I'm equally happy about that. For over a year now, since our two prime ministers spoke in March 2020 and identified common priorities, the endeavor on both sides has been to focus on translating their vision of taking our bilateral relationship to a new era. And our governments have since then, ever since I arrived, I've just been at it, but our governments have since then been committed to removal of trade barriers and encouraging collaborations in innovation and technology development, particularly in sectors where our nations have complementary capabilities. And the successful collaboration between Oxford, AstraZeneca, and the Serum Institute of India, and the One Web project of Bharti Mittal are excellent examples. Right now, as we speak, our scientists are looking at this new variant in India and seeing how the rest of the world can be given relevant information on that. This is really the kind of real-time cooperation that India and the UK have the potential to do as natural partners because of these complementarities, if I may use such a word. In fact, in a COVID-impacted world where healthcare has become the biggest priority, where nations are working together and alone and together to secure, manufacture and stock essential supplies from APIs to sophisticated drugs, vaccine and equipment, India and the UK have proven that we are actually partners in bringing the solutions. So that's a good thing. And whether it is a space sector, as I mentioned, or motorcycles, chemicals, India is an experienced and reliable partner. And our companies are poised to come in to the UK to make new acquisitions, bring capital and expertise. They're looking at NHS, education, banking, all these things which really came to the fore and were focused on during the pandemic, online education, for example, and they're ready. And there are many other major players who are already waiting to come in and working with partners here. All our constituents of the living bridge that links our economies in their unique way. I am glad that the skills and qualities of women in key positions That has been recognized in this report as a factor of good outcomes. I'm waiting to read more about it. I would very much like to hear from these women in key positions about how they think that they made a difference. What are the methodologies? What was the new thing that they brought in? I'm confident that with the launch of schemes by the government of the UK to attract Indian students and encourage youth mobility also, there's bound to be a good outcome and a ripple effect of that as well, because I feel that they would have a familiarity with the UK system, greater numbers of students bringing greater talent, and then later, hopefully, investing into the ecosystem that they have grown to know well. And of course, at each new level of success, our Indian companies will feel encouraged to explore further opportunities. And it's really up to both our governments also to work together. And we want to do that. There is a political will now to provide them more stability, more predictability, and other conducive conditions. So there are obviously issues related to various aspects of the relationship. The more active we get, the more intensive the engagement, the more issues will come up. And that's a good thing. They would be related to regulation, interoperability, there may be challenges, but that is for us all to iron out. And both our governments are equally desirous of making sure that entrepreneurs and companies on both sides succeed. I just would like to share that I hosted an open house at the High Commission last week in which 27 top British companies participated. And I'm aware that my distinguished counterpart, High Commissioner Alex Ellis in Delhi, had a similar exercise for Indian companies in Delhi. So High Commission of India is determined to make this a sustained dialogue with UK companies working in India or looking at India. And we stand ready, as always, to address the issues raised by Indian investors from time to time as well. So I value the regular dialogue between our High Commission and business chambers in India and across the UK. And our virtual consultations and events have always been extremely useful. As soon as feasible, my colleagues and I intend to have in-person meetings in London and the different regions and directly engage and support our companies and the companies that are, you know, the Indian companies coming into the UK or the potential investors. So with these words, I wish all the stakeholders on both sides the greatest success, and I stand ready to work with them. My colleagues and I stand ready to work with them in the coming days. So all good wishes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Lord Grimson, for joining us this morning and the inspiring words. And I identify with your words of concern, and thank you for your concern expressed for the people in India who are going through a harrowing time. And we do hope, and I'm confident that we will prevail once we begin to respond to the situation in our country. And this is what the second wave is all about. So despite that, we will carry on virtually now that we are out of the second wave. So let's do our best. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, High Commissioner, for your equally inspiring words. And this is what keeps us going, as you rightly said, despite the challenges, both in India as well as we had previously in the UK. Life goes on and Indian investments continue to grow. Thank you very much for joining us today. We really appreciate that. Thank you very much. Can I now request our dear friend from our collaboration partners, the Confederation of Indian Industry, to Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, very fondly known as CV, and he has been at the forefront of strengthening the Indian India Inc. story, should we say that way, for a very, very long, long time. And it's a privilege for us at Grant Thornton to have CII as our collaboration partners and work very closely with CV. CV, over to you for your remarks. We're just running just behind schedule, so can I just request you to keep your speech brief, sir. Thank you very much. And thank you, High Commissioner. You can probably switch off your cameras now. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chandru. Lord Grimson, our Honorable Minister for Investment of UK. Great to see our High Commissioner, Ms. Gayatri Kumar. Great seeing you. Met virtually ever since you have taken over We have only been, unfortunately, meeting virtually, but we have been meeting and we have been working. And I guess most of your work, since ever since you have taken over, has been on virtual mode, but real outcomes is what we are seeing. So congratulations to you, and thank you very much for leading India right there. I would also like to acknowledge Dave, Anuj, of course, Chandru, and I did see Jay Shroff, and I believe many of our friends also there, some of them not been, and one has not been able to see them. I believe Karan, Lord Birimoria, is pretty much present. Hi, Karan, and many others. So all a very, very distinguished gathering. Thanks all, and great to have you all at this very important moment of time. Lord Grimston, of course, we have had the great pleasure of working with you before you were wearing this hat at the India-UK CEO Forum, as you co-chaired the UK side, and lots of work we were able to accomplish under your leadership when you were on this side of the table. And now that you are on that side of the table, the good results of this report also gets a lot attributed to you as a Minister of Investment. So great to meet you, and thank you for this continued and valued friendship and guidance. So with Grant Thornton, one has continued to have this leadership, great leadership by Grant Thornton in conducting this research jointly with us year on year. And as we live in very, very difficult times today, and thanks for those expressions of solidarity for India. Like at the rest of the world, we will come out of this very soon, hopefully. And today, you know, as we see this great report which has been presented, we see the phenomenal contribution of Indian companies. Indian companies today are competitive, globally competitive. Indian companies are expanding. Indian companies are looking for new investment opportunities, and Indian companies are contributing to the economy in various parts of the world. And UK is indeed a very, very strong friend, a valuable partner, and it gives phenomenal encouragement for us to see this and present to you this most valuable piece of research that underscores really this importance of the India-UK economic partnership. 850 odd companies adding 50 plus billion pounds in the net revenue, and more than 116,000 jobs. The increase in figures from last year substantially, in spite of the times that we have gone through, and the report over the years has come to become a very, very valuable resource for furthering growth and expansion of Indian footprints in the UK and of course beyond. And that we map how regional footprint has grown has led to a real sharp focus on the importance of regional India partnerships, causing the number of Indian companies in the regions to grow, and that we map diversity of statistics of Indian companies. Our High Commissioner very, very nicely mentioned some of the points on that, and really has led Indian businesses ensuring that their boards are incrementally more diverse and much more inclusive. As Chandru said, we don't have much of time, so I really not want to go into details, but as champions of the UK-India economic partnership, the report findings truly indicate trends and also the mood of Indian investments in the UK. And I hope that you will find the findings of this report and use this tool as we present to you very, very extensively. I'd like to really particularly thank the Indian industry, the key stakeholders across the region, our MOU partners, Grant Thornton, of course, the High Commission of India, the UK government for supporting us through this journey. Stay safe, stay well, and I wish you all success to continue to make a meaningful contribution as you always do. Thank you. Thank you. Back to you, Chandru.
Thank you, CB. Thank you for those inspiring words, as always. It's an absolute pleasure for us at Grant Thornton to work so closely with you, Lakshmi, Marut, and the rest of your team in furthering the India-UK relationships. Very quickly moving forward, can I now request my colleague and mentor, Anuj Chande, head of the South Asia Business Group at Grant Thornton UK. Anuj has been hemming the South Asia Business Group over 3 decades now, so I don't want to give his age away, but he has been at the forefront of helping so many Indian businesses succeed in the UK markets for a very long time. Anuj will be sharing with us the key findings of this year's India Meets Britain Track report. Over to you, Anuj, for your remarks on the findings of the report. Thank you.
Thank you, Chandru, and thank you for those kind words. And can I just make a couple of personal remarks before I share the findings of the report? First, I'd like to add my personal thanks to all the guest speakers who have given up their time to their valuable time to attend this session. Particular thanks to my dear friend Jay Shroff, who was one of my first clients back in the early 90s when we when he first looked at a UK acquisition in the UK. So particular welcome to you, Jay, as well. I think the other thing I would just like to mention, and it's been mentioned here, that we've spent 30 years in this corridor. And personally, I've spent 30 years in this corridor. And there have probably been a number of occasions when I would say there's a watershed incident. The first being when we had 2014, we had the end of coalition governments, and we had a majority government that took power in 2014. I would say that 2021, for me, certainly from my perspective, is also a watershed year, given that in the post-Brexit environment, the UK is looking to strengthen its global relationships outside Europe. And of course, India is at the forefront. And what is particularly encouraging is that our report is highlighted, as you will see once you get the report, that in 2020 alone, there were 10 acquisitions by Indian companies of UK businesses. And that's the highest number out of all the countries in Europe. So that is quite a testament to the India-UK interest and partnership between the two countries. So if I can move on to the specific highlights of the report, and some of this information has already been shared by previous speakers, but this year, our report has shown that we have 850 Indian companies in the UK, only marginally up from last year when it was 842. But that actually masks an underlying degree of activity. There were actually 83 new Indian companies that entered the United Kingdom, whilst there were a number who either were sold or were restructured or in some cases dissolved. And as has been mentioned, there's a 20% increase in the combined turnover to just under 51 billion. And in terms of taxes, just in corporation tax alone, they're paying £500 million. And if you were to add payroll taxes and sales taxes, the figure would be substantially higher, maybe double or even triple that number. As has been mentioned, diversity is a big issue that we look at. And it's very encouraging to see that this year, of the 850 companies, 47% has female representation on the board, which compares very favorably with either peer numbers or those numbers in India. One of the things that we look at in terms of the report is we look at the fastest growing Indian companies. Now, in order to qualify to be on the list for the fastest growing, the business has to have been trading for 2 years and have a minimum turnover of 5 million and have achieved a 10% growth in revenue. So if we were to look at this year's tracker, we have 49 companies that are on the tracker list. Could you move it to the next slide? Yeah. Oh, sorry, I beg your pardon. I did want to discuss the employment footprint. Just in terms of employment footprint, and as had been mentioned by CB earlier, we have a record number of employees that Indian companies employ at the moment, and it's 116,000 this year. And as you can see from this graph here, there's been a gradual increase over the years. I think one important point that I'd like to highlight here is that this excludes the employment numbers for any branches. And if you were to take the top five technology companies that are located in the UK, then that number, which is estimated at 30,000, would need to be added to this number. We go to the next slide. I can then talk about the tracker that I was talking about earlier. So in terms of the tracker this year, we have 49 companies that are on the tracker this year, which have achieved the criteria that we've set out with a combined turnover of 2.6 billion and a stupendous average growth of 40%, which is quite amazing. The largest of which has had a growth rate of 158%. Size-wise, there is a very similar footprint to previous years, where you've got 4%, which are above 250 million. You've got just under half, which are between 25 and 250 million. And then you've got the remainder, which are between 5 and 25 million. And what's very personally satisfying to know that two of those companies that have qualified for the tracker are represented today on our panel, those being Diligenta, which is ultimately owned by Tata Consulting, and Arista Life Sciences, which is owned by UPL. If I can move sector-wise to what it looks like from a sector perspective, the tracker has shown that technology and telecoms remains the top industry sector at 41%. What is encouraging is that pharmaceuticals has almost doubled its representation, and so now represents 27% of all Indian companies. And that's particularly apt, particularly in the environment that we're living in the last year with the pandemic. We also then engineering and manufacturing has taken a bit of a reduction down to 8%. And you have what's encouraging also to see is that financial services remains there at 4%. And it's very pleasing to see that two financial service, Indian financial services companies are in our tracker, that being ICICI and Kotak Mahindra, despite some of the uncertainties about passporting rights post Brexit. From a location perspective, you've got London still being very much a dominant player in the market. Having said that, you know, CB's point is valid that the regional footprint is slowly sort of trying to edge in and try and reduce that dominance that London presents. But up until now, for this year, you know, London still represents a significant element in terms of the location of such companies. And as I mentioned, certainly from a diversity point of view, we look at diversity. And what we found this year is that in terms of the tracker companies, 53% of the tracker companies had a woman director on their board, which compares very favorably to the 47% has been mentioned earlier in terms of the total population of 850. I think one of the things that this draws out and this is sort of commentators in this area do indicate that diversity can lead to business success. So perhaps there is some evidence here that we need to look at to see that there is a direct link between diversity and business success. I'm very conscious of the time, so rather than give you my further thoughts on the future, I'm going to hand back to Chandru, who will celebrate the success of the Indian companies that are in our tracker this year for 2021. Over to you, Chandru.
Thank you, Anuj. Thank you. And can I request you to stay on while we celebrate the success of some of those Indian companies who have been on the tracker report this year? In a normal environment, we would have had this launch, a physical event, and we would have given out awards and certificates to some of the fastest growing companies across various sectors, as well as the top employers. But of course, these are virtual times, so we are going to celebrate the success of these companies virtually. So to begin with, the first award we give is for the company that has topped the list of the tracker this year, the fastest growing Indian company in the UK this year. Hearty congratulations to Team Birlasoft. Birlasoft Solutions Limited has grown at a phenomenal 158% year on year as per our tracker report research. So congratulations to Team Birlasoft on this wonderful achievement to topping the tracker list. Very quickly moving on to our next award, which is for the top employer. Of course, no prizes to guess who this is. Tata Motors Limited has been getting this award year on year for a long time now. and they employ in the UK over 40,000 people through Jaguar Land Rover and other subsidiaries in the UK. So hearty congratulations and very well done to Tata Motors Limited for being the top Indian employer in the UK once again, as per our tracker report. We then look at the various sectors and companies which have topped in the various sectors. So in that segment, the technology sector, as Anuj said, has been the fastest growing sector in terms of number of companies there. And again, Birlasoft, he's the fastest growing Indian TMT company in the UK as per our tracker. So hearty congratulations once again to Birlasoft Solutions on getting this acknowledgement and award. The second sector which we talk about is the pharmaceutical sector, the fastest growing Indian pharmaceutical company in the UK as per our IMB tracker for 2021 is Life Molecular Imaging Limited, again grown at over 100% year on year, owned by the Piramal Group. So hearty congratulations to Team Piramal as well as Team Life Molecular on this achievement. The third sector, Anuj mentioned about the financial services sector. It's an absolute privilege to announce this, that the fastest growing Indian financial services company in the UK as per our tracker report is ICICI Bank UK PLC. As per our tracker report research, ICICI Bank has grown last year at over 83% year on year, led wonderfully by Mr. Loknath Mishra. So hearty congratulations to Lok and his team and to Team ICICI Bank on getting this award. And then finally, the last sector is the engineering and manufacturing sector. And in this segment, the fastest growing Indian company in this sector is Chloride Eastern Limited. Hearty congratulations again to Team Chloride Eastern, having grown at over 50% in this segment. So we would have ideally loved to do this award in a much more grander manner, but these are difficult times and we had to do it this way. But hearty congratulations to all the winners, Team Birlasoft, Team Tata Motors, Team Life Molecular, ICICI Bank and Chloride Eastern on this achievement. Thank you very much. So that brings the award ceremony to an end. And I'm now going to request my colleague, Pallavi Bakru, tax partner and head of India-UK corridor at Grant Thornton Bharat, to come online and conduct this, what is going to be a phenomenal panel discussion. We've got some great speakers. So over to you, Pallavi. We're looking forward to this interaction. Thank you.
Thank you, Chandru. Can I request Jay, Amit, and Lakshmi also join us? Perfect. A very warm welcome to all of you. I'm so glad that, you know, you've all made the time to be a part of this discussion. You know, as we've heard, the pandemic has been, unprecedented. We've all sort of face the ravages of it in our own way. In India, you know, we still continue to be in a very trying place. You know, we've seen the collateral impact it's had on people, livelihoods, businesses, and in fact, the economy at large. But I think what's been encouraging are the stories of resilience and success, you know, that we've also heard how people and companies have reinvented themselves and, you know, not just managed to survive, but also succeed and be acquisitive. You know, Anuj just spoke about the fact that, you know, despite everything that's going on in the world, there have been acquisitions and, you know, technology has probably been the front runner. And we've seen a very similar sort of thing play out in India as well. You know, whether it's pure play technology or technology enabled companies, you know, there's been a lot of action. And I think, Amit, that brings me to you. You're the UK and Ireland head for TCS. TCS is the crown jewel of the Tata Group, the largest IT company in India. Your subsidiary in the UK recorded a 62% growth. I mean, that's an astonishing number. You're also the fourth largest employer. You employ close to 5,000 people in the UK. And, you know, there's been a lot of excitement over your announcement that you're going to add another 1,500 high-skill jobs in the UK. So what's been your success mantra? And, you know, how do you see this playing out in the sort of scenario we are living in right now?
Thanks, Pallavi. First and foremost, many thanks to the entire team at CII and GT for hosting us. I think when we look at our UK business, As Anuj also hinted upon, it's Diligenta is a subsidiary of ours, but we also have a branch-led business in the UK. And put together, we have close to around 18,000 employees in the UK. A very significant presence for us, both in terms of scale, but also in terms of the contribution to UK businesses. If we look at last 12 months, very different last 12 months than what we have all experienced before. But fundamental to what we have experienced is the role of purpose. And the role of purpose either in ensuring that one continues to be resilient to feed the nation, to support the nation, to connect the nation. And that's where we have seen technology to play a pivotal role. And we take pride and fortunate to be part and parcel of that journey across the different leading enterprises in the world. Having said this, we have also expanded the purpose to ensure that community is not left behind. And we have taken the rightful measures at scale, both for not only for our customers, but also for community and employees. Whether it is in terms of bridging the digital divide, whether it is in terms of taking care on the back of technology so that the help is secure. Any of those facets do keep us going and do take pride in terms of our ability to contribute our little.
And I think that's a great point you made about purpose. I think profit with purpose is you know, something that a lot of very forward-looking companies are now embedding into their DNA. So, I mean, that's, I think, a great path to lead on. Jack, coming to you, you're the global CEO of UPL. You know, we in India are very familiar with UPL as United Phosphorus Limited. You know, you're a large listed company. You're in the field of providing crop solutions to support agriculture. You have a very global footprint. So, I mean, you know, you're looking at a space where, you know, there are concerns of food security down the road. You know, climate change is a big issue. So, you know, you're in a very sweet spot in terms of the industry you are in. You've also been a quick sort of embracer of technology. You know, I was kind of reading up on you and I picked up that, you know, you've embraced the MIT Media Lab's philosophy on open agriculture and, you know, how it's being used to sort of encourage innovation within the space of agriculture. So just wanted to understand from you that, you know, how did Arista Life Sciences happen? You know, what's the plan for it? And, you know, what's been the growth story so far?
Thanks, Pallavi. Thanks, everyone. Anuj, for inviting me today. Your Excellency, good to see you. No, UPL is transformed itself from being a purely crop protection chemical company to being a solutions provider. Today, we see ourselves as a company focusing on sustainable solutions in agriculture. We have a whole portfolio of technologies, and we've been investing for the last 10 years or so in technologies to fight situations like climate change, reduce water reduction, reduce chemicals, reduce fertilizer, really make agriculture more sustainable, because we believe that agriculture it can be the biggest tool to fight climate change and for CO2 reduction. So we are very excited that UPL has built a platform. And as you rightly said, Open Ag is a purpose for open collaboration. We collaborate across the world with, we have at the last count about 300 projects on collaboration at our Open Ag Center in North Carolina. We have farms where we do research on technologies, partner with all kinds of companies. In fact, we have one in the UK too, where we are testing technologies to reduce water requirement in agriculture by 30-40%. And it's been quite successful. So there's a lot of transition happening in the food systems. And, you know, our purpose, our goal is to actually make farmers more resilient in a country like India, where small farmers are the primary food supplier. Making sure that they are more resilient will change the whole system. And even our Prime Minister is completely focused on doubling farmer income. And we are actually designing technologies and tools to drive that. Talking about Arista was a company similar size as UPL. It gave us a global footprint. We acquired it about 2 years ago. We integrated it completely into the UPL system. And today UPL is in about 15 markets around the world, a leader, market leader in crop protection and technologies. And number five in the world, almost 90% of 92% of our business comes from outside India. So we are a truly global company. I would say that almost every farm must buy at least one UPL product across the world. So we have achieved an interesting status, and now we are enabling the farmers using technologies. So it's a part of a journey, and we continue to work hard towards making food systems more sustainable.
And I think it's been an amazing journey. And as I said, for those of us in India who've been tracking it over the years, you do us proud. Lakshmi, don't face in this panel. You represent CII in the UK. CII is a very premier body connecting the industry to the policymakers. You probably have your ears to the ground far more than any of us here. So just wanted to get a sense from you, in terms of what's happening within the industrial spaces. Are you seeing anything beyond technology and pharma? I mean, we just heard Anuj mention that, 68% of the investment in the UK is, technology and pharma and chemicals. So, and it's consistently been this way. Do you see a change? Do you see something else, any sunrise sector coming up where you think, could be a surprise? Or are we going to see more of what we're seeing now, particularly post the pandemic, more sort of accent on technology and pharma? So it'd be lovely to have your thoughts.
Thank you, Pallavi. It's good to see you. Hi, Commissioner, Your Excellency. It's always a pleasure to have you join us and encourage us. It's only been virtual interactions with you, as Mr. Banerjee said. I really hope that with the lockdown, opening up, we're able to see you in person, Lord Grimstone, Honorable Minister for Investment. Pallavi, first of all, I'd like to say that seeing more of what we are seeing is actually quite diverse. Here, with Amit and Jay talking about two completely contrasting, spheres of work. Food, agriculture is very, very vitally important. It's one of your traditional, sectors, if you like. But putting food on the plate, putting healthy food on the plate is very, very important. And so is making sure that we are environmentally, conscious. What Amit does, so technology, data is the new gold, right? Somebody calls it the new oil, somebody calls it the new gold. But technology is... it would be kind of unfair to call it a sector, really, because technology, it governs every aspect of our life today. It's sector agnostic, really. It's the enabler.
It's the
agility factor in everything that we are doing, how your production will be, how effective, how efficient your systems are going to be is all going to be driven by technology. So I certainly see greater investment and focus in digital infrastructure. We've all seen, can you hear me? Can you see me all right? Those sort of things. So one will very, very rapidly see, and there are plans within London as well as elsewhere. You see the coming in of 5G slowly being adapted, across our lives. The focus on lives and livelihoods. CII has maintained throughout, this whole conversation around battling the pandemic, overcoming it. The situation, we've not gone past it yet. While we might think that we've overcome it, but it's still work in progress. We don't know if we're 100% beyond the pandemic, and it's still a while before we can call ourselves foolproof. The vaccination drives are going ahead. There's so much that is going on currently. So more of what has been happening is reassuring, it's encouraging that, work and businesses are progressing as normal. Today is also Earth Day. Today is the 22nd of April, and it's a good day to remind ourselves of the compassion that Amit's talked about, of the responsibility aspect of, not just to the environment, to society, to industry, to each other, being cognizant of one another's, you know, requirements, needs. And that's what industry has done well. I mean, I'm often asked, what is it that the Indian industry are doing different from anybody else that is making them grow year on year on year when everybody else is, you know, worrying about how the numbers are falling apart? And it makes my heart swell with pride to see that Indian industry have steadily gone, you know, gone ahead, demonstrated its resilience, and you know how strong we are, not just as each company, but really as industry and as a country, Pallavi. So more of what we are seeing enabled with you know technology and future tech, future skills will be you know very much part of the conversation. You'll see more and more skill sets becoming robust, a more resilient response to pandemics, healthcare systems, life sciences. Will be definitely what we must look forward to.
I know, and particularly in the times we are in, I guess those are going to be the key focus. So Amit, there seems to be consensus around here that you know technology is going to be a mainstay for a lot of us, irrespective of what we do. So just wanted to understand from you, what are your drivers to grow growth in the UK?
I think a good amount of demand is already captured in this conversation. Which is a good highlight.
That's what I said. There is complete consensus, but
absolutely. But I think
shying away from technology.
Absolutely. If we look at technology, it's in a way to Lakshmi's point, not being an industry, but it's actually a unifying fabric, which cuts across industries, cuts across ecosystems, and that's also the sense of both our investment and growth in the UK. If you look at UK, while it's the second largest market for us globally, quite significant and scaled as well, we clearly see that there are two streams and threads of businesses growing for us. One is companies have been pushed towards resiliency, and we see more and more demand coming towards efficiency-led resilient operations. So I think that's a given. But at the same time, we are seeing increased investment towards transformation. Loosely put, people call it digital, but more specifically put, it is pivotal around new business models. Yeah? There is a new emergence of online channels, only channels, new evolution of supply chain, new evolution of journeys, be it customers, employees, stakeholders. So we clearly see the impression of new demand on the back of transformation coming in. And if we put all of this together, where we stand is, and that's also captured in a refreshed brand statement that we launched a few weeks back of building on belief. And that's essentially an impression of getting the future set right, but ensuring that we're putting the right foundation and building it together. As an organization, if I quickly reflect, we are an organization which is very heavily invested in sponsorships of marathons across the globe. And that's a reflection of the DNA also.
I picked that up.
We don't play short. We always play long term, but with sprints in between. So we'll always run the marathon, but you'll also see running the sprint so that we don't lose a bit. I think that's in a way sums up us at large, also specifically for the UK as well.
Just a quick follow on to that. I mean, how has UK played a part in it? I mean, you know, you're seeing growth everywhere, whether it's India or other parts of the world as far as TCS is concerned. Anything that's been critical to UK, and you know, what's been your learnings in terms of, you know, growing a business in the UK? Anything you want to share with, you know, our wider participants here today in terms of your successes?
Just reflecting on last 12 months, and I'll draw some parallels. So UK has been in a very specific position. While the world was dealing with one challenge at a macro level being the pandemic, the UK was dealing with more than one. While pandemic was there, there was also an uncertainty around Brexit, and which was a nervousness for many businesses, both in terms of consumption as well as demand. But given what we have seen, both in terms of the vaccination success in UK, and then the uncertainty of Brexit being left behind, I think the outlook is very positive. And that is reflected in the demand that we experience, that is reflected in the investments, not only that we make, but also our customers and communities are making. The UK businesses are up for a completely reinvented, reimagined way of doing business. you see companies coming together. We've never heard of competitors coming together. Just to quote an example, and it was in the public media as well. M&S partnered with around 11 high-speed brands to sell products on their online channel. You would have not heard of this come before. So we are seeing companies coming together in an ecosystem play, but also being very conscious of being purpose-led ecosystem, not necessarily only a profit-led ecosystem. So we clearly see that emergence coming. Last 12 months also taught us the lesson on resiliency, which was never tested like what it got tested in last 12 months. And you spoke about Diligenta, which is the leading player for UK in the life and pension space. And resiliency of operations was visible because of the nature of demand which was coming in terms of pensions, in terms of queries around the economics and the compensation for employees, skyrocketing. But it was right at the forefront of being digital and ensuring the right experience. So many positives for us to take.
Great. Jay, coming to you, sort of what brought on the decision to have a significant presence in the UK with the acquisition of Arista? And sort of also share with us what have been your sort of learnings, you know, as you've acquired Arista and grown it to what it is today and, you know, integrated into the wider UPL.
No, I think my initial experience, of course, UK is a very easy environment to operate in. You know, my first very interesting story I'll quickly tell you is way back in 93 when we first acquired our business in the UK. I negotiated the deal. I got my approvals with the boards to buy the company. I paid for the company. I took control of the company. And this was when, of course, in India, we had a lot of controls. And I, after about a month into the acquisition, I realized, oh my God, but I didn't talk to anybody in the government. We bought this business. We paid those days 10 million pounds, and I had no interaction at all. Nobody from the government. Should I be talking to some bureaucrat? Should I be informing somebody?
Alien experience from India.
And I said, my gosh, you know, I didn't meet anybody. And am I missing something? And soon realized that there was no involvement in the government in an investment. I brought in money. I bought a company. I took charge. I changed the management, did what I wanted to, and no interaction. So, I mean, you know, these are unique experiences which was very, very different for me. I think the legal system, UK's, we feel at home in the UK. We understand that culturally, Indians are very well accepted here. We are part of the society. So it's very easy to do business with. Financial markets are also there. I remember it used to be SBI Europe Bank. Those days doesn't exist anymore. It became SBI and all the other investment banks we used to talk to. You know, it's a deep rooted market. And I hope with this Brexit, the UK government can energize that sector and incentivize that sector to keep staying there, because I think it's a very, very important part of us, all of us investing in the UK as a platform into Europe and the first step, stepping stone towards investment in globally.
I know. I mean, I think Madam High Commissioner also made that point about, you know, the cultural bridge. And it's very interesting to know that, you know, beyond curry, cricket and cinema, there is a lot that sort of keeps both the nations together in terms of wanting to do business with each other. Lakshmi, coming to you, I know you've been a big supporter of the regions. And, you know, we've seen in the report how, you know, London sort of predominates in terms of the number of industries. What do you think that the regions need to do a little more to attract Indian businesses?
So the regional story is something that India's taught the UK. I have to share that. You know, a few years back when, you know, Anuj and I and were talking about what else can we measure in the report, we talked about diversity on the boards, and we talked about the regional footprint. India has very, very you know, active sort of states and union territories that are driving growth at that level. And therefore, it was a good learning to take naturally from India. You know, I come from India. So to draw that here, that energy into this country and make sure that the regions are equally competitive And Pallavi, as if we look at last, you know, couple of years of the report, the moment we started tracking, for example, diversity, once we started mapping diversity statistics, and ma'am actually did talk about, you know, I'd like to know what, how did that change? It changed because the moment you start tracking these figures, they start showing, you know, they start becoming visible in your understanding, your psyche. And it kind of gets embedded that, all right, we're being watched, right? You know, we are going to be measured on this. Similarly, the regional story works in a similar way that, you know, once you talk about the region, the more you talk about it, the better focus that you have. And you see it translate into statistics. I mean, there's been an increase, say, by a few percent, but there has been an increase, a steady increase in, you know, the footprint of Indian companies across the regions. And why that is important is that not everything will be relevant to companies, for example, in London. There are also opportunities elsewhere. There are strengths elsewhere. The entire UK has many focus areas, many sectoral capabilities, you know, materials research, life sciences. You have a Center for Life, you know, up there in Newcastle. You have, you know, data labs and data science experts in Scotland. You know, you look at the whole country and you've got manufacturing hub, you know, in the Midlands. So you've got capabilities everywhere. Similarly, you've got capabilities all over India. So if you match up and connect regions to the states and union territories of India, and you make sure that Indian companies are not just told that, you know, there are just, you know, UK is not equal to London, just as India is not equal to Delhi or Mumbai. There is more to both the countries than just that. And, you know, we have very, very prominent businesses, big businesses, small and medium businesses. Now, even, you know, with this, you know, focus on entrepreneurship and startups and scale ups, there is so much expansion, almost like an explosion of opportunities for Indian companies and Indian entrepreneurs everywhere. It is leverage the opportunities that you have across the country, that you have that kind of focus, and we must do that. So, Pallavi, finally, I'd also like to say that the report, you know, for whoever's reading it, has not just been a report, you know, stating statistics. It's almost work in progress. I mean, today's day, I'm quite passionate about, you know, environment, social governance, you know, corporate governance sort of issues. So the ESG has become a buzzword today. But ESG is something that Indian companies have been working on aspirationally, progressively, additive, in a very, very additive manner for years and years and years, right? I mean, the compassion that Amit's talked about, giving examples, not just from the UK, but there's so many examples, you know, from India that you could think of, has to become embedded more visibly as part of our understanding. So in addition to the diversity statistics, in addition to the regional statistics, I think here on, we would also like to measure the ESG compliance statistics, you know, for our companies. And that would make it really befitting to the companies and their profiles that we are. And we are driving conversations. We are driving those decisions, not just for our own, you know, businesses, but for the nations whose story that we are shaping as businesses that operate as local UK businesses in this country, right? I mean, our companies are not any different from how they function. They contribute to the local fabric of this society here, right here. So there is so much more.
That's a very valid point you're making. And I think, you know, speaking about the gender diversity bit, I think India is one of the few countries which has made it mandatory to have women on the board. Of course, we've made that, you know, redundant today because we outweigh the men on this panel, thanks to Madam High Commissioner joining us.
But heavyweight, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I can see Chandru here, so that's a cue for me to, you know, call this a wrap. So, Jay, Amit, Madam High Commissioner, Lakshmi, thank you so much. It's been absolutely delightful talking to you all. And I'm sure for all of us who've been here hearing you, there'll be sort of fabulous takeaways for us. So thank you very much. And over to you, Chandru.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pallavi. Thank you. I would also like to express my gratitude to you, Pallavi. Thank you for joining us, Jay, Amit, Lakshmi and Ma'am High Commissioner, thank you for being with us for the launch of this report. And we hope that this is not just the launch of a report, but this is a report that we will look to leverage and talk with the findings about it for times to come, because that's the whole idea of this report, to act as a toolkit for us to talk about Indian investments in the UK. So thank you very much, High Commissioner, for joining us. I would actually like to express our gratitude to Minister Grod Grimstone for joining us, Chandrajit Banerjee at CII, and all our guest panelists who have joined us for the launch of the report. Thank you very much. Just moving on, I would like to just share our contact details for anyone who would like to get in touch with us to discuss the findings of this report. And the link for downloading the report can be seen below for all of you. So just copy the link and you can download the report. The report link will also be available in the chat box. So you can also copy the link from the chat box here on this GoToWebinar platform. And of course, we will be emailing you a copy of the report as well. So that brings to an end what has been a very fascinating launch of the 8th edition of the India Meets Britain track report, launched and produced by Grant Thornton UK in collaboration with the Confederation of Indian Industry. Thank you very much, all of you, for joining us. And that brings the launch event to an end. All I have to say anymore is take care, stay well, stay safe, and look forward to seeing you all very soon. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.